Amen.
The Savior alone, He carried the cross for all of my debt. He paid the cost. Salvation complete. Now forever.
Every voice.
Hello viewers all over the world. Welcome to the ever increasing word feast. Erick Habuwele is my name, and I'm back again to share with you the word of God, which is going to be of a great blessing. I believe that at the end of this message, you are going to be blessed. At the end of this message, you are going to be blessed. Now, I'm going to minister to you the word which I have entitled as the confession of sin. What is confession of sin? And hey, I may say something that may go against what you have believed before, but all I ask from you is don't be in a hurry to criticize what I'll say. I know what I'm going to say is critical, it's going to go against a lot of people's belief, but don't be in a hurry to criticize. Be patient with me, and for this one, I'll make sure that the scriptures are displaying on the screen so that we can be going together on the same page. And the first scripture I'm going to read is going to come from the book of 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 15 to 17. The scripture says, "And that from a child thou hast known the holy scriptures, which are able to make thee wise unto salvation through faith which is in Christ Jesus." This was the time when Apostle Paul was admonishing his son in faith called Timothy, that my son Timothy, from childhood you have known the Holy Scripture, and the Holy Scripture have made you wise unto salvation in Christ Jesus. Now, in 16, he said, where the Scriptures they profit, in verse 16 says, "All Scripture is given by inspiration of God, and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness." Verse 17 says, "That the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works." Now, in 16, it says, "All Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine." Doctrine here, it means teaching. It means learning. It means learning outside doctrine. We don't have learning as Christians. And reproof here, it means conviction. It means evidence. So meaning, scriptures has got to be evidence in your life. No any other thing can replace the evidence that the scripture gives concerning the faith which is found in Christ. And then the scriptures are given for collection. Meaning, anything that you have embraced before for long, and then when you meet scripture, the scripture tells you to say, put that thing away, go with this. You've got to put away that which you held on to for so long, and go by what the scripture says. And the scriptures are given for instruction. Here it means tutelage. Instruct here, it means chastening. So scriptures, they are the one which chastens us. So it is very important to be submissive to scriptures. It is very important to go by what scriptures are saying. What you know is not final. What you know can never be final. It can only be final if it is authenticated by the scriptures. So throughout this learning, scriptures are going to authenticate us. Throughout this learning, scriptures are going to guide us. Now, here again what the scripture says in the book of James. James chapter 1 verse 16, scripture says, "Do not err. Do not err, my beloved brethren." Do not err, my beloved brethren. The question we should ask ourselves is, why do people err? Why is it that people err? The reason why people err, Jesus Christ, He answered it in the book of Matthew. Matthew chapter 22, verse 29. Scripture says, "Jesus answered and said unto them, ye do err, not knowing the scriptures, nor the power of God." So once you don't know scriptures, you land yourself into error or into heresy. Remember, the scripture we're just from reading, it says, the scriptures, they make you wise. They make you wise, meaning The wise, to be wise, is the opposite of error. When you error, you become fool. You become foolish. When you error, you become a fool. Many at the time, Paul addressed people as foolish, foolish, foolish. Why was he calling them foolish? They were foolish because they were erring from the scriptures. Also, Jesus, he called his disciples in the book of Luke chapter 24, verse 25. He said, "Oh, ye fools and slow of heart to believe." That word slow, yeah, it is taken from a Greek word called blados, blados. And blados, it means dull in understanding the scriptures. That's why in 45, it now says, "And opened he their understanding that they may understand the scriptures." Now, hear what the scripture says in the book of Matthew, Matthew chapter 1, verse 21. This was the mission statement of Jesus Christ. "And he shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins." So the primary reason of Jesus Christ coming here on earth was not to give you a car. The primary reason of Jesus coming here on earth was to take away sin, or was to save man from sin, sin which had gripped man for so long. Man could not save himself from sin. That's why Jesus, he came to help man out of the sin. Again, scripture says in the book of Matthew chapter 26, verse 28, "For this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for many for remission of sin." For many for remission of sin. The word remission there is taken from a Greek word called aphesis. Aphesis. And aphesis, it means to release from bondage or imprisonment. To release from bondage or imprisonment. So Jesus, he came to release mankind from bondage of sin, or from imprisonment of sin. Again, the same word aphesis, it means forgiveness or pardon of sin, letting them go as if they were never committed. So the blood of Jesus, or the blood of Jesus, yes, which is shed for many for the remission, this word remission, which is aphesis, it is taking you away from your sin to be as though you never committed any sin. It is the separation. As far as the east is from the west, so have he separated you from your sin. There is no meeting point between you and the sin which you had committed. There is no meeting point between you and the sins which you were in. You were separated from the sin which was keeping you bound. You were separated from the sin which held you captive. You were separated from the sin that kept you in bondage. Again, hear what the Bible says in the book of Ephesians. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 7, scripture says, "In whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sin, according to the riches of his grace." According to the riches of his grace. No, no. The forgiveness of sin is in his blood. The forgiveness of sin is in his blood. The forgiveness of sin is found nowhere else apart from his blood. Again, listen to what the Bible says in the book of Colossians. Colossians chapter 1, verse 14. The scripture says, "In whom we have redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sin." So forgiveness of sin is only on the basis of the blood of Jesus. The forgiveness of sin is found nowhere else apart from in the blood of Jesus. Again, scripture says in the book of Hebrews, Hebrews chapter 10, verse 12, the scripture says, "But this man, after he had offered one sacrifice for sin forever, sat down on the right hand of God." So Jesus, he offered one sacrifice for sin forever. Remember, we say this, the mission statement of Jesus Christ was to save man from his sin. And the scripture says, when he did that, he did it perfectly, and it was once and forever. "But this man, after he had offered one sacrifice for sin forever, sat down on the right hand of God, of God, from henceforth expecting till his enemies be made his footstool." For by one offering he has perfected forever them that are sanctified. So by one sacrifice of Jesus Christ, you have been sanctified. By one forgiveness of Jesus Christ, you have been sanctified. By the sacrifice that is offered once and for all, it has perfected you and me forever. The Bible says again in the book of Hebrews, Hebrews chapter 8, verse 10, scripture says, "For this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my laws into their mind and write them in their heart, and I will be to them a God, and they shall be to me a people. And they shall not teach every man his neighbor and every man his brother, saying, Know the Lord. For all shall know me, from the least to the greatest. For I will be merciful to their unrighteousness, and their sins and their iniquities will I remember no more." So God is saying, this was a prophecy. This was a prophecy that was to say, when Jesus Christ, when Jesus Christ has offered the sacrifice for sin, he himself, he was the sacrifice. Jesus was the sacrifice for sin. So God was saying, when Jesus Christ is offered as the sacrifice for sin, this is what I'm going to do. I'm not going to remember their sins anymore. Why? Because all the punishment for the sin will have been taken care of by Jesus Christ. And this word, remember no more, it doesn't mean God to have a loss of memory. God to have a loss of memory. No. The way it says, remember no more, it means to overlook. Why overlooking? Because of what Jesus Christ has done. God is going to overlook because the price was already paid. Now, there is a scripture which a lot of people have problem with, and this is a scripture which acts as a stronghold to a lot of people arguing about the confessing of sin. Confessing of sin in the book of 1 John, 1 John chapter 1, verse 9. First of all, what you need to understand is that the book of 1 John chapter 1 was not written to the church. This 1 John chapter 1 was addressing the Gnostics. The Gnostics which John was defending the gospel. Hear how it starts. Normally, the letter which is written to the church, it will start greeting to this church, greeting to that church, this and that. He will address, but this time around, he was defending the gospel against these Gnostic people. In the book of John chapter 1 verse 1, the scripture says, "That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon, and our hands have handled of the word of life." He was telling them to say, the one we were with Jesus, we saw him, we handled him, is the one we are proclaiming to you. Now in verse, let me show you to say this was, he was not addressing Christian, but he was addressing non-believers. In verse 3 it says, "That which we have seen and heard, declare we unto you, that ye also may have fellowship with us. And truly, our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ." Here he was addressing this non-believer to say, when you believe in this Jesus, you shall have fellowship with us. You shall have fellowship with us. These people, they never had fellowship with God. That's why he was telling them to say, you need to have fellowship with us. Again now, in verse 7, it says, "But if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanseth us from all our sin." He was telling them to say, if you accept Jesus, you shall have fellowship with us in the light, and when you accept him, his blood cleanses you from all your sin. Cleanses you from all your sin. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. Now, I want to take you back to few, just to the scripture which we are from reading. He said, if we have fellowship with Jesus Christ, his blood, it cleanses us from all sins. And remember to say, the Bible, it never had chapters, it never had verses. It was just a flow of thoughts. It is just these theologians who divided the Bible, putting chapters and verses for the sake of easy reaching where you want to be. But this time around, let us just read it as a continuous thought. "But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, We have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, His Son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. See, it's just from saying, if we receive Jesus, His blood cleanses us from all our sin. And then in another statement, He says, if we say we don't have sin, we deceive ourselves. That does not agree, because if His son's blood has cleansed us from our sins, it means we don't have sin anymore. So here, He was addressing two kinds of people. He first of all addressed those who are in the light, to say, us who are in the light, the blood of His Son, it has cleansed us from all our sins. From all our sins. Again here, He is addressing now those to say, those of you who have not received Jesus, the sin that you were born with, is still with you. And if you denounce that sin, He is able to forgive you. In verse 9, He says, if we confess our sin, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. From all unrighteousness. Now, the word sin here, is taken from a Greek word called hamartia. Hamartia. And hamartia, it means to miss the mark. Hamartia, it means to wander. So, this hamartia, it is the sin, it refers to the sin that was passed unto us from Adam. It refers to the sin that was transferred unto us from the disobedience of Adam. This hamartia, it is not the sin that is committed by you. No. This hamartia, it is the sin that is passed on unto you from Adam to you. Because anyone born of a woman is born under sin. Anyone born of a woman has sin. So this sin is the sin that is passed on from Adam to anyone who is born of a woman. Like what the Bible says in the book of Romans chapter 5 verse 12, the scripture says, wherefore, as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin. And so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. Because of one man's action, sin came into the world, and sin affected everyone, and for that everyone was called a sinner. And for that everybody sinned. This does not mean everybody committed sin. No. The sin that was committed by Adam, it was transferred and it affected everyone. That's like what the scripture says, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. That was not referring to us. Everyone has sinned as sinned an individual sin. It was too referring to the sin of Adam. Now in chapter 2, 1 John chapter 2, this time around He was now addressing believers. This scripture now He was addressing believers in the book of 1 John chapter 2 verse 1. Scripture says, my little children, these things write I unto you, that ye sin not. And if any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. Here the scripture doesn't say if any man sin he should confess. It does not say if any man sin he should say God forgive me. No. Here He says if any man sin, we have an advocate. And then now the word sin here is taken from a Greek word called hamartano. Hamartano. And hamartano, it means to miss the mark. It means the sin or the wrong acts that are committed by you. The wrong acts that are committed by you now as an individual says, when you commit those wrong acts, do not have a sin consciousness with knowing to say, Christ, He has taken care of that wrong. A lot of people, they think like when preachers are preaching about grace, they are giving people license to sin. That can never be true. Anyone who hears the sincere message of the grace of Christ, they are free from sin. The only message that can save a man, from condemnation, is the message of grace. Anytime you expose people to the message of grace, they are free from sin. There is no one who is exposed to the message of the grace of God and continue to sin. Then that person, he does not understand the message of grace. And it continues to say, and He is the propitiation of our sins, and not for our sins only, but also for the sins of the whole world. So Jesus Christ, the forgiveness that He has given unto us, it is for once and for all. Jesus, he has forgiven us, past, present, and the future. Those who insist that in 1 John chapter 1, verse 9 is proof that Christians must keep confessing their sins in order to be forgiven and made righteous, will find it inconsistent with 1 John chapter 2, verse 12. 1 John chapter 2, verse 12, listen to what the scripture says. I write unto you, little children, because your sins are forgiven you for his name's sake. Here the scripture says, your sins are forgiven not because you have confessed. Your sins are forgiven because of the name of Jesus, because of the sake of Jesus. Meaning, your sins are not forgiven because you are a good person. Your sins are not forgiven because you give tithe. Your sins are not forgiven because you have fasted. Your sins are forgiven because of what Christ has done. Once you put this in your mind, you shall not have any struggle. Now, am I against confessing of sin? No, I do confess my sin, but this is how I confess my sin. I tell God to say, God, thank you because my sins are forgiven in Christ. I don't confess to God for him to forgive my sin. No, why? Because I know that I have forgiveness of sin in him. And where am I? I am in him. I am in the forgiveness of sin. And my sin he does not remember anymore. So this is how I confess my sin. Let me tell you, confessing of sin can never bring justification to you. Confessing of sin. And let me tell you something. When somebody has been taken to court and has been found guilty, there is no amount of saying I'm sorry which can acquit him. There is no amount of crying which can make the judge to judge according to his favor. There is nothing that can happen. The only thing that can happen to that person is to serve the sentence finished. And we were found guilty. When we were found guilty, what happened? Jesus Christ, he carried that punishment and he paid it. And when Jesus Christ paid it, he freed me. I don't have any other thing to say to Jesus apart from saying thank you for taking that load which was supposed to come upon me. Thank you for taking that sin which was supposed to come upon me, and I am forgiven. I am forgiven. This is the confession that you are supposed to make. This is the confession that I make. I don't confess for my sins to be forgiven. Listen. The more conscious you are of how forgiven you already are in Christ, the more you will truly live above every defeat. The more you walk in the consciousness of the forgiveness of sin, the more you live the life above addiction, the more you live the life above defeat, the more you live the life that is a triumphant life. It is when you realize that your sins are forgiven. So long you are still under the mentality of saying God is punishing me because of what I did, I tell you, you shall become a victim of identity crisis. Now listen to what the Bible says in the book of Matthew chapter 9 verse 2. The scripture says, and behold, they brought to him a man sick of the palsy, lying on a bed. And Jesus, seeing their faith, said unto the sick of the palsy, son, be of good cheer, thy sins be forgiven. This man, when he was brought to Jesus, he was brought to Jesus to be healed. But listen to what Jesus Christ told him. Jesus told him to say, your sins are forgiven. When he was told that your sins are forgiven, what was the resultant effect? The resultant effect, we see them in verse 6. Verse 6 says, but that ye may know that the Son of Man has power on earth to forgive sin. Then said he unto the sick of the palsy, arise, take up thy bed, and go unto thine house. So this was as the resultant effect of the forgiveness of sin. This was as the resultant effect of the forgiveness of sin. It is the blood of Jesus that continually cleanses you from all sins. Not your confession, not your continuous confession of sin. Your continuous confession of sin does not in any way take away sin from you. The more you confess of your sins, the more sin conscious you become. Like what the Bible says in the book of Hebrews chapter 10 verse 1, the scripture says, for the law, having a shadow of good things to come, and not the very image of things, can never with those sacrifices which they offer year by year continually make the comer there unto perfect. For then would they not have ceased to be offered, because that the worshippers once purged should have had no more conscious of sin. But in those sacrifices, there is a remembrance again made of sin every year. So the more they kept on offering sacrifice, that sacrifice kept on reminding them how sinful they were. That sacrifice kept on reminding them of unworthy they were before God, that they were guilty. It is the same with somebody who keeps on confessing, saying, God, I'm a sinner. God, I'm a sinner. If you have Christ in you, you are not a sinner. The confession you are supposed to be making is, God, I am righteous. God, I am holy. God, I am redeemed. I am above sin. I am a winner. Don't confess that you are a sinner. Then when you're confessing that you are a sinner, it means you are rendering what Christ did irrelevant. You are rendering what Christ did ineffective in your life. Amen, somebody. Thank you very much for being with me up to this time. Hope you are blessed by the little message I have shared with you. Don't forget to share, subscribe, as well as to comment to my YouTube page. God bless you. Shalom, shalom.